playing a prelude. Isaiah, will you just let me not to sing or play?
Welcome, everybody, to Park Street Church, for those of you who are here in person, as well as those of you who are online. We hope and pray that the time will come soon that we can all worship here physically together in the sanctuary again. But welcome, and we're glad that you can be with us for fellowship and for worship. Let us first do our call to worship from the words of Psalm 28. Praise be to the Lord, for he has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord is the strength of his people, a fortress of salvation for his anointed one.
Thank you. Please bow your heads with me. Father God, we adore you. You are marvelous. Your good works are too numerous to count. Your creation is stunning. Your works can't be compared. Father, we praise you. We adore you right now. We confess, however, that we're not worthy of your praise. Holy Spirit, show us our sin. Show us our shortcomings, the places we fall short, the way we focus on self more than you and more than others around us. We strive for prominence. We strive for promotion. We look for success and power. Holy Spirit, have mercy. Father, have mercy. We think of all the times that we get anxious. We say we trust you. We say you are magnificent and will do mighty things for your people, but we fear instead of trust you. Father, help us hold tight to your word. Expand our view of you. Expand our view of others. Help us humble ourselves, becoming less. Make our worship be about you and less about our preference, our status quo, our comfort for how we like to worship. God, help us know that when we read your word, we believe what it says. When you say that you want us to worship you in spirit and truth, show us what that is, that we may do it, that we may honor you in your house and wherever we are, in our home, around the city, that we may worship you with our lives wherever we are. May this time of worship be pleasing to you, Father God, Jesus, Holy Spirit. May we lift you up. And at this time, we pray together those familiar words that Jesus gave us as a model. We say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our coming day's bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into trial, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, this is a time we will pass the peace to each other. And I know it's a little odd as we're socially distant. Some of us might not be with other people to pass the peace. But if you're around others, we know that Jesus is our peace, that because of his sacrifice, we're reconciled to God, our Father. So if you're with others, you can do an elbow bump or a wave or a peace or whatever you'd like to do. If you're alone, feel free to pick up your phone and text a friend. Or feel free to say to the screen right now, as you're saying to the church and anyone who's watching, peace of Christ be with you. Now, brothers and sisters, pass the peace of Christ to each other. My name is Cindy Cutlip. I am an elder here at Park Street and honored to be that. And I'd like to welcome each one of you here today. Wherever you are, welcome. If you're a newcomer, please go online after the service. There's an information portion where you can fill out and so we can know you even though you're not in person. We really want to know you and we are honored to welcome you into our community. I do want to give a special shout out to any college students who might be coming back to Boston or might be coming to Boston for the first time. We're such a big college town and we honor you and we want you to feel that you are welcome here in Boston. So please don't be strangers. Please don't stay isolated in your dorm room or campus or apartment, but please be in touch with us. We would really be honored to hear from you and know that you're here in Boston with us, at least for a short time. I want to tell you about something new that happened this morning. We had a new 8:30 a.m. service that took place here in the sanctuary. This was held in person, the first time we've done this since COVID began. It was a more formal liturgy than we're accustomed to seeing here, but I hear it was beautiful. Just the same, people were socially distant from each other. They were wearing masks. There was no singing, but the liturgy was beautiful, and the Lord was worshiped well at 8:30. There's a pre-registration to do this in the future. It's required to come here, and you can do that online because we're letting a little over maybe 100 people come. So please register instead of just showing up, and we'd be glad to have you if you've registered. Next week, there's an all-church meeting. This is going to be a hybrid meeting. This is Friday the 21st. In the meeting, Mark Booker, our pastor, will be giving an update of his first months here at Park Street Church as our new minister. We will share the leadership vision. He will share the leadership vision for the fall and provide a time for question and answer. Like I just said, this will be a hybrid event, so some people can attend in person if you've pre-registered online, but others can watch live, and both are acceptable. Questions will be taken online so that everyone will be able to participate. Again, please pre-register. Our church is not a building, it's not a steeple, it's not our music, but it is the people who come here, it's the people who worship together. So I want to say that whether you are just coming on for the first time or you have been coming a long time, I want you to go online and look at all the things that our church community does, even though we're not open. Our doors are pretty much not open. Our community is open. So please go on. Let's see, what is it called? parkstreet.org/announcements. Anyone can go on there and you can see all the things that we have to bring us into community at this time. Lastly, our church is deeply committed to world missions. Beginning August 28th, we are offering a course on world missions that's called Perspectives on the World Christian Movement. Please watch this video to get a taste of the value in participating in this upcoming class. Thank you.
Perspectives is a 15-week course designed around four vantage points: biblical, historical, cultural, and strategic. Each one highlights a different aspect of God's global purpose. The biblical section, with striking clarity, illustrates God's unchanging promises as they unfold from Genesis through Revelation. The historical section is wrought with the immeasurable power of God. From Abraham to today, you'll walk in the shoes of believers who God has used to pave the way and set the stage for all of us to join in the story. You will understand your Christian heritage like never before. The cultural section explains the expressions of the New Testament and how God wants all people from diverse backgrounds to be involved in His purposes in culturally relevant ways. The strategic section is the exclamation point. You will learn how to practically live as a disciple, leveraging your passions, training, and expertise for God's global glory. In addition to the class being 15 weeks long, students will hear from 15 local, regional, and national instructors. Students will hear firsthand from the global experiences of pastors, professors, biblical scholars, mobilizers, theologians, missiologists, and missionaries from the field. Also, every student is welcome and made comfortable academically by the three levels available: key reading, certificate, and credit. This class is for the business owner, stay-at-home mom, pastor, high school student, retired, everyone.
Have you ever tried to put a puzzle together without having the box with the picture on it? It's almost impossible. Well, for most of my Christian life, that's exactly what I was trying to do. See, I was trying to put all the pieces of the Bible and of human history together to make sense, but I didn't have the big picture. I didn't have the box. Perspectives course is the box. It's the big picture of what God has been doing all through history.
I think the best word picture that I could probably use to describe it was when you go to the movies and you're watching a 3D movie on the big screen, and they give you the glasses to look through, the 3D glasses. And if you look at the screen without the glasses, everything is so out of focus and you can kind of see what's going on, but it's not really very clear. But then when you look through the lens of the glasses, everything comes to life, everything is in perfect perspective, and you can understand so much more clearly what's going on. And to me, that's what the Perspectives course did for me. It helped me to understand much more clearly God's heart, His plan, and how I can be a part of that.
I think overall the class just did an amazing job of explaining God's heart for the nations. It's so easy to get caught up in our own lives, and Perspectives really helped pull us out of that and refocus us on God's Word.
I became a Christian just a few years ago, and my life has continued to radically change throughout different seasons of life, but it has amazed me how much I didn't know or see about God's global story that is presented throughout the Scriptures, and Perspectives did an amazing job at clarifying that.
God has a role for every Christian in His narrative. Whether people sell all their belongings and go to a distant country or stay at home is a secondary issue. God uses us all. The primary issue is what most people are hungry to discover, a vision to live a life of purpose. Discovering that vision makes this course valuable and perhaps crucial for any Christian. This 40-year-old movement is part of a long history of believers and is making a huge kingdom impact on a local, regional, national, and global level. This is your personal invitation to join us. Please visit perspectives.org or contact your local representative for more information.
Church, as we continue to worship, please stand if you're able. Our next song is Awesome is the Lord Most High, and let's just declare that now that we have an awesome, awesome God.
Yeah.
Our Old and New Testament readings today are from Jeremiah and 1 Peter. Jeremiah 23, verses 1 through 6. Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says to the shepherds who tend my people. Because you have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not bestowed care on them, I will bestow punishment on you for the evil you have done, declares the Lord. I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them and will bring them back to their pasture, where they will be fruitful and increase in number. I will place shepherds over them who will tend them, and they will no longer be afraid or terrified, nor will any be missing, declares the Lord. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up to David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. This is the name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness. The word of our Lord. Our New Testament reading comes from 1 Peter 5, verses 1 through 5. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, as a witness of Christ's sufferings, and one who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. The word of our Lord.
Together as we open up God's word. Almighty God and Father, we worship you this afternoon. You are glorious and good, and we come to you expectantly. As we open up the scriptures, may you speak, Lord, loudly and clearly to each one of us. You know our different contexts, our different states as we come to this time and what we need, and we ask that you would give us exactly what we need, that we would hear with ears opened by your Spirit, and that you would form us more and more into the image of your Son, Jesus. We ask this in his name and for his glory. Amen. It is good to be back after a few weeks away. It was especially good, actually, to be with real people in the sanctuary this morning at 8:30 for the first time since I've started this ministry with you here, and it was really a joy. We had a wonderful time with extended family. The purpose of our trip, which was to Colorado, was to honor my father for his 80th birthday this summer and gather with extended family. We also had a great time with our immediate family. We took a backpacking trip for 5 days, and something we've done routinely over the years. And it was a joyful time to be out in the mountains, which is a place that I come alive and am grateful for. As we were hiking out on the fifth day, our kids were at the stage in our life where our kids are more physically capable and certainly more physically resilient than we are. So they had run on ahead with their backpacks, and Mandy and I were lagging behind. And I said to Mandy, the word that keeps coming to mind from this time is reset. This has been a reset, a restart in a good way for my soul. Often if you're working with a computer and you do all kinds of things that you try and nothing works, the best thing to do at the end is just to reboot the computer. In many ways, that's what our trip away was like for me personally. So I'm really grateful for that. And our children and Mandy are also grateful for the time away to God, and thankful for the rest we had together. We're really happy to be back as well, and we look forward to deepening our ministry together with all of you in the coming months and years. We are back in 1 Peter today, nearing the end of the letter. After a few weeks of considering suffering in chapters 3 and 4, we now move with Peter into chapter 5 and verses 1 through 5, where he offers instructions to church leaders. And I would say in any church where there is a breakdown in the relationship between elders and pastors and the congregation, there are obviously significant problems that result, and our ministry is hampered and our witness is diminished. We can easily become distracted, and we are prone to the attacks of the enemy and far more susceptible to discouragement and disillusionment. Needless to say, the Christians in Asia Minor to whom Peter is writing had plenty of reasons already to be discouraged and disillusioned. The last thing they needed was an unhealthy context within the church and with their relationships with one another. So it's perhaps no surprise that Peter addresses relationships in the church by addressing leaders and leadership directly in order that this church might be healthy and its witness strong. You might think for a moment that this text, especially verses 1 through 4, doesn't apply to you, especially if you're not an elder or a pastor and you have no aspirations to be. But I would say, and I trust that we'll see, that all kinds of leadership roles exist within the church, and that what Peter shares here specifically to elders applies to all of us in those roles, whether it's through a hosting ministry or hospitality or ushering or small groups or T&O or COVID-19 rapid response teams and on and on. If you are involved in Christian ministry, and to some degree, all of us who are disciples of Jesus are engaged in genuine ministry, then what Peter shares here does apply. Furthermore, verse 5, he gives two exhortations, one to those who are not elders, and we'll look at the nuances of that later, and also then one to the whole community, to all of us, which certainly apply to every one of us as well. Our plan is to take these three exhortations in turn. There are three here in these five verses. And we'll spend most of our time on the first one, which comes in verse 2 and is expanded through verse 4. And then the last two come in verse 5. And again, all three of these exhortations encourage health in the church. So first, Peter's exhortation to the elders, shepherd God's flock, verse 2. The NIV has, be shepherds of God's flock, but it's really a verb there. It is shepherd God's flock. That's the exhortation. Do this, shepherd the flock of God, serving as overseers, Peter goes on to say in verse 2. In his book from about 10 years ago, Timothy Whitmer, the book is called The Shepherd Leader, unpacks the task of shepherding with four key responsibilities: know, feed, lead, and protect. So to the elders and pastors of this church, I would ask, do we know, feed, lead, and protect those whom God has entrusted to our care, using Peter's language here? Or to all of you who are involved in leadership in some kind of Christian ministry with others, do you know, feed, lead, and protect the brothers and sisters in Christ that God has entrusted to you in that ministry? This is, in fact, the primary focus of leadership in the church, to shepherd. And that means that we are to be primarily, as leaders, about people, which is both wonderful and challenging. Last fall, as I was working through the discernment with the Senior Minister Search Committee to hear God's voice and to discern his call, I had to fill out some written responses to some questions. And one question was, what do you love most about the local church? And my response was easy. I said, people. I love calling people to an exclusive love for Jesus and to working out the implications of that in our lives together and individually. The next question was, what about ministry in the local church frustrates you? And I think that answer was also easy. I said, people. And that includes me. We are broken and sinful. We're messy. We hurt each other. And that makes ministry in the church oftentimes hard and unglamorous. And it's true. Being about people is both glorious and gloriously challenging. It is easier to focus on big visions, on daring ministry projects, on running programs and events, on doing ministry together. And of course, all of this is part of the life of the local church. But Peter's call here to the leaders, to the elders, is to say that ministry in the church, and particularly leadership in the church, is all about people. I wonder if that is reflected in the way that we pray. in the way that we spend our time. We might ask, well, where did Peter learn this central lesson? And of course, we need to go back to Peter's own story, to his own calling and to his role of leadership within the church by Jesus himself. And this has to be in mind as Peter exhorts the elders in Asia Minor, as he says, as a fellow elder in verse 1, though he's more than that, of course, he is an apostle, but he says a fellow elder. And then he mentions in verse 1 that he is a witness of the suffering of Christ's sufferings and one who also will share in the glory to be revealed. And I have to believe that as Peter recollects the sufferings of Christ, he also remembers how he made those sufferings far more acute by the denial of his Lord 3 times. And then, of course, the story of his subsequent restoration. Many of you will remember that story that we read about in John chapter 21. The disciples had gone fishing for the night. They hadn't caught anything. This man on the shore yells out at them, "Throw your nets on the right side of the boat." They do so. They haul in a large catch of fish, 153 of them. Peter realizes that it's the risen Lord. He takes off his outer garments, jumps into the sea, and swims to shore to see Jesus. What's on the shore? What's on the beach when he arrives? It's a fire, which is significant because during the 3 denials, Peter had been warming himself by a fire in the courtyard. And there's a fish on the fire. Jesus has prepared breakfast, and tenderly and with care, he feeds his disciples breakfast. And then we have this memorable, unforgettable exchange between Peter and Jesus, where 3 times Jesus says, "Peter, do you love me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And then Jesus commissions him, "Feed my sheep, tend my sheep, feed my sheep." The work of a shepherd. That middle exhortation, "tend my sheep," is the same verb in verse 16 of John 21 that is used here in 1 Peter 5:2. Shepherd God's flock. As Jesus commissions Peter, it's a beautiful thing to get the sense of the personableness of Christian ministry and Christian leadership. It is about people, to know them, feed them, lead them, and protect them. This is what we are called to do in Christian leadership. The church is not about metrics. It's not about programs. It's not about being a big institution. At the end of the day, and particularly for leaders, the church is about people. We serve a God who cares deeply about people. And that means about people's stories. That means about pain and heartache and joy and all that comes with each one of us in our complex lives. Leaders in the church, elders in the church, are to care deeply about particular people. That is a reflection of the God that we serve. The most well-known psalm in the Psalter, of course, is Psalm 23, which depicts our God in the form and the image of a shepherd and us as sheep, sharing to us something about the shepherd heart of God, that God longs to know, lead, feed, and protect his own people. The sad reality of the Old Testament, the Old Covenant people, is that God had put people in charge in Israel and commissioned them to shepherd his people, but they had turned away, as we read about in Jeremiah 23. "Woe to the shepherds who are destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture. They've scattered them, driven them away, and have not bestowed care on them," it says in Jeremiah 23. And that verb there, "not bestowing care," is the same verb in the Septuagint that it is that we find in John 21, 16 and 1 Peter 5:2. This idea of shepherding, tending. The tragedy of the Old Covenant people and the leaders that they were to reflect the shepherd heart of God to his people, and yet instead of serving his people and caring for them as shepherds, they served themselves and cared for themselves. So God speaks in verses 5 and 6 of Jeremiah 23 of the day when he will raise up to David a righteous branch, a king who will reign wisely and do what is just and right in the land. That king, that righteous branch, is of course great David's greater son, Jesus, who when he comes among us and walks among us and ministers among us, says of himself in John chapter 10, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, and I lay down my life for my sheep." Jesus perfectly represents the shepherd heart of God to his people. And this good shepherd, whom in verse 4, Peter calls the chief shepherd, calls then under-shepherds to serve under his authority in the context of his local church to shepherd his flock, those entrusted to our care. Jesus calls them to be shepherds, and then Peter reflects that call here. Empowered by the Spirit, forgiven through the cross, we are to shepherd God's flock that is under our care. In verses 2 and 3, Peter gives three qualifications about this, around this exhortation in three contrasts, and I want us to look at each of those three briefly. First, he says, shepherd God's flock not under compulsion or because you must, but because you are willing. Do it willingly, intentionally, deliberately. Those of us with kids or who are around kids regularly know what it's like to see someone do something because they must and not because they want to. When we ask our kids to clean up their rooms or to take out the trash or to clean up the kitchen, there is often, not always, but certainly sometimes, the dragging of feet, the furrowing of the brow, the sigh, and then the kind of laboring through the task. That is not the way that a leader within the church is to go about his or her ministry. Instead, Peter says, there is to be a willingness, a readiness, a deliberateness about this. This is what God values when we offer him service of any kind. Think of 2 Corinthians 9:7. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion. That's the same word for because he must here in our text. For God loves what? A cheerful giver. The attitude that Paul commends in the giving away of our resources is the same attitude that Peter here commends for the offering up of our role of shepherding. Our heart matters in this, which is to say that if you find yourself in a position of Christian leadership, furrowing your brow, dragging your feet, sighing, then it's a good indication that you're not operating in that ministry out of the grace of God in the service that he's called you to. No doubt leadership in the church can have a kind of burden, as can all Christian ministry. I think of Paul and his list in 2 Corinthians 11 of the areas of suffering in his life, and he adds at the end of the list, the daily pressure on me of the anxiety of all the churches. There is a burden in Christian leadership that is uniquely borne by Christian leaders. But Peter's exhortation is to take up this burden willingly. Don't be forced into it. So I want you to ask yourself, how is your service to God being offered in your life right now? If it feels more like a forced march, then I would encourage you to take some time, this week even, to reflect, to pray, to seek some counsel, to share with a close friend or a pastor about what's going on in your life. Remember, God loves a cheerful giver, a cheerful shepherd, a cheerful hospitality coordinator, a cheerful teacher, a cheerful bulletin folder, and so on. Anytime we're giving to the Lord from our time, talent, or treasure, God is pleased with a willing heart. So that's the first qualification, not because you must, but willingly. The second, in verse 2 still, is not greedy for money, Peter says, but eager to serve. Another way of saying this is that Christian leadership is not about what we can get, but about what we can give. The driving force of the elder, of the leader, or of Christian leadership in general, and I would really say of any good leadership, whether it is defined as Christian or not, is how can I give to those around me so that they can thrive? How can I give to those around me so that they can thrive? That's essentially what shepherding means. It means giving of our resources, mental, physical, emotional resources, to provide for those sheep who are under our care. I love the way Paul puts this again in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 15. He says, as he writes to the Corinthians, they've had a tumultuous relationship. It's been broken in some ways. And he says this about his own heart. He says, I will most gladly spend and be spent for your souls. That's a great model for a Christian leader. To want to spend and be spent for the souls of another means that we are motivated not by monetary gain or any other kind of gain that we might receive, but we are motivated by love. Love which is at the heart of the Christian life, a love that is willing to pour out for the sake of the good of another. The hired hand, Jesus says in the Good Shepherd passage in John 10, when the wolf comes, will flee, will run away because he's just a hired hand. The Good Shepherd will stay because he loves his sheep. And it is love that keeps Jesus our Lord hanging on the cross when he's challenged to show his glory. If you are the Son of God, then come down. And it's love that holds him there. It's love that leads him to be the good shepherd who lays down his life for his sheep. So that's the second qualification, not greedy for money, but eager to serve. The third is in verse 3. He says, Peter says, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. Let's think about what Jesus taught and about what Jesus did. First, what did Jesus teach on this point? Matthew 20, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you, but whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be your slave, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus taught this very thing, not lording it over. What did he do? How did he live? Think about that beautiful moment after supper, the Last Supper, John 13, when Jesus gets up from the table, takes the towel, ties it around his waist, takes the form and posture of a servant, and washes his disciples' feet, signifying the cross that he would bear the next day on their behalf. And then he says to them in John 13, I have given you an example that you should do to one another as I have done to you. Not lording it over those entrusted to your care, but being an example is what Peter says. That's exactly what Jesus taught and exactly the way that Jesus lived. On our backpacking trip, we summited La Plata, which is a 14,000-foot peak in the Rockies. And on most mountains, at least in the Rocky Mountains, there are large boulder fields. They're called talus fields. And a lot of our hiking in the route that we took was over and across talus fields for hours on end. And they're kind of challenging to hike on. It takes practice. I love it because it engages your mind and your body as you're hiking across these boulders. There were many times as we were hiking through the talus on that trek that I would say to my kids, follow close behind me, kids. Step here, not there. Step on the rock that I step on. Stay close so that you know the way through. And in many ways, that's the model of Christian leadership. It is to live a life in such a way that people could look at your life and say, this is how I am to navigate through the challenges and complexities of life in today's world. Look at that person. Look at that person. Look at how they live. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:1, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Leaders within the church are to live an exemplary life, a life that shows others how to walk by faith in a world of challenges and sorrow. Yes, it is in fact a high bar, but it is possible by the grace of God in our lives and by the Holy Spirit who empowers us to live a new way. And this is the calling that Peter says is upon the lives of the elders that he's exhorting here. Peter seems to know this is a really high calling. It's a challenging bar to set for leaders. So in verse 4, he gives us a sense of looking forward to the reward. And he says, and when the chief shepherd appears, as you've shepherded in this way, as you've shepherded like Jesus, Jesus more than anyone else, Jesus embodies one who comes willingly and not because he must, one who is eager to serve and not in it for gain, and one who doesn't lord it over. He could have, but instead lives an exemplary life and calls us to follow. When you shepherd in this way, you will receive, Peter says in verse 4, the crown of glory that will never fade away. In the Greco-Roman world, crowns were given to athletes who would win competitions. We had a modern-day reprise of that tradition in the 2004 Summer Olympic Games in Athens when the medaling athletes all received an olive wreath on their heads along with their medals. But those wreaths would fade. Those crowns would fade. Peter says, not this crown. This one's different. This glory will never fade away. You have been born again into a living hope. You have an inheritance that is imperishable and undefiled and unfading. And that's what you're looking forward to. So press in as leaders within the church. Press into this role. Give yourself fully to it in the power of the Spirit. And know that this glorious reward is coming. So that's the end of the first exhortation, shepherd the flock. Much more briefly, I want to deal with the second and third exhortations, both of which come in verse 5 and expand, in a sense, those that he's exhorting. Having exhorted the elders to shepherd in this way, Peter then addresses those who are not elders. The NIV translates the word younger men, and it is a possible and fair reading of the word, but it's also possible to understand this reference to the younger as those who, yes, may be younger in age, but also as those who have a different position within the church. That is, those who are not elders. And this has been an ancient and modern reading of this text that exists within the tradition. In that sense, this is an exhortation to anyone who's not a leader within the church, to those who are followers, and good leaders in the church need good followers in the church for it to be healthy. And the exhortation is to submit to your elders. The NIV translates that the older, but it's the same exact word that's used in verse 1 for elders. And like the call for all of us that Peter gives in chapter 2, verse 13, to submit for the Lord's sake to every human institution, Peter now applies that principle of submission within the church for good order, for health, and for the flourishing of the body. We should be quick to say this isn't about blind obedience, but it is a kind of deference that exists under the final and full submission of everyone within the church to the Lord Jesus himself as the chief shepherd. Elders and pastors can, and no doubt do, get out of line, and they need to be checked. We need to be checked by those who do not hold those offices within the church. But in general, the congregation, according to Peter here, is to have a posture of deference to its leaders, a posture that will enable them and their leaders to grow to greater spiritual maturity together as we take up the different roles that God has given us, and a posture that will help the church be healthy and to bear faithful witness. The final exhortation in verse 5, again, is an exhortation that Peter issues to all of us, whatever age or position we have within the church, and it's a call to humility. A call to humility. He tells us, all of us, to clothe ourselves with humility toward one another. And that word for clothe yourselves is a little different than the normal word for clothe yourself, which we get in Colossians 3:12, for example, in the New Testament. This word here means specifically to tie something on oneself. And the something in this case would be the servant's apron or garment. We remember back to John 13, Jesus got up and tied a towel around his waist, taking on the form of a servant. And this is the very thing that we are called to do with one another. We are called to humility. This is the key to a healthy church, one that can withstand the pressures of being aliens and strangers in its culture. What do humble people see clearly? I would suggest they see three things very clearly. First, they see their own sin. They see that they are not what they were supposed to be. They see that their heart and motives are often mixed and impure, and it keeps them aware of their sinfulness and of their lowliness. Second, they see the glory and beauty and majesty and holiness of the God that we worship and serve. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Humble people see this glorious, holy God in all of his radiance and beauty and power. And thirdly, they see the beauty of the gospel, which is that this holy God bridged the gap with these sinful people like us and made a way for us by entering into the world through in the person of his son, Jesus, that we might know him, dwell in his house forever, engage with him, and participate in his kingdom work together with him. It's an incredible reality that God has bridged this gap and enabled us to share in this life with him. So humble people see their sinfulness, God's holiness and glory, and they see the way in which God has brought these two things together by his grace, not because of what we deserved. John Newton, the writer of the famous hymn of Amazing Grace, said in a remark that many of you will know from near the end of his life, he said, "Although my memory is fading, I remember two things very clearly. I am a great sinner. And Christ is a great Savior." The humble are so overcome by these most basic realities of their lives, of their own sinfulness, and of God's grace and glory and holiness, that they're not really that impressed with their own business or professional success, with their pedigree, with their education, with their level of knowledge. They are simply sinners saved by grace, who have bowed the knee to the risen King Jesus, who have bowed our heads before him and allowed him to make us what he wants us to be. Peter defends this exhortation by citing Scripture. Proverbs 3:34, James 4:6 also cites the same verse, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Perhaps there's not a better verse in the Bible than this one to remind us of just how awful pride really is, because pride leads to God's opposition, whereas humility to God's grace. And all we desperately need, all of us really need in our lives, is we need God. So that is an encouragement for us to ask God to shine the light upon our hearts for where we are proud, where are we impressed with ourselves, where do we think that we're better than other people, where are we not clothing ourselves with humility. Asking him to make these things known to us that we might repudiate them and repent of them and hand them over to him, that we might know more and more of his love and grace. So Peter says, put that kind of humility on yourself. Wear that in your relationships with one another. And it's an exhortation that, if followed by all of us within the church, I believe would quite literally transform God's church. We cannot shepherd without humility. And I would say this is just as important, we cannot be shepherded by Jesus, the chief shepherd, or by his under-shepherds, our leaders, without humility as well. It is something that we all need in the church. On our trip to Colorado, my dad told me the story of Doug Nichols, 1966 in London. He was on cleanup crew for the Operation Mobilization annual conference. And he was out cleaning the steps on the conference center about 12:30 in the morning, and an older gentleman, walked up and had just a single bag and asked him if this is where the conference was being held, and he said, yes, it is. And the man said, well, could I have a place to stay? And Doug was a little bit surprised because everything had kind of been put up for the night. He was the last one out sweeping the steps, but he said, now, I'd be glad to help you. And he led this older gentleman into a room where 50 other people were bunked up for the night. The man didn't have any bedding or anything, so Doug found him a blanket and gave him a towel for a pillow. And then he asked him, are you hungry? And the man said, yes. And so they went and kind of had to pick the lock to the kitchen and got in and ate and shared a little bit. And the older man told Doug a little bit about his ministry in Switzerland. The next day, the leaders of the conference showed up, and they were aghast to find out that the keynote speaker for the conference that day had spent the night in the bunkhouse when they had a special room set aside for him. And the man's name, this keynote speaker, many of you will know, was Dr. Francis Schaeffer, a man that God had used so wonderfully and brilliantly already at that point by 1966, that he was well-known, towering intellect, faithful minister of the gospel, a humble man, who demonstrated in that moment a willingness to receive Doug's simple hospitality without identifying himself with a fanfare and just receiving what had been given and sleeping on the floor with everyone else. That's a picture of the kind of humility that Peter exhorts all of us to within the church, to have this, whether we're leaders or followers or both, and we are all both in different contexts. He encourages us to clothe ourselves in humility toward one another. And there is only one way to grow in this as the people of God. It is through encountering Jesus, the humble King, who embodied in his own life and embodies in his ongoing ministry with us this kind of trait, being willing to associate with the lowly. Jesus emptied himself and became nothing, taking on the form of a servant. And as we encounter this Jesus, as we know him, as we fellowship with him by opening up his word, by engaging with one another in community, in prayer, in solitude, we find that he renews us, shapes us, and changes our hearts from the inside out. That we, as we encounter him and commune with him, might grow to become more and more like him, and to become more and more clothed in humility as we engage in life in all of its complexity and one another in the life of the church. That's my prayer for us, Park Street Church, is that we will grow as a people of humility as we lead and as we follow, that we will hear these exhortations of Peter to be about people, and yet to be about people means that we need to be humble, and in that humility, God will make himself known, and our witness and our ministry will be fruitful for his sake. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do ask that by your grace and mercy, you would grow in us this kind of humility, that you would teach us more of your presence and power and your holiness, of our own need and dependence. Oh Lord, we pray where we have been sidetracked by programs and numbers and activities and events and lost sight of people, that you would call us, all of us in our own way, to be good under shepherds of the true chief shepherd, Jesus. That we would be a church known for its emphasis upon and focus upon people. People that you created in your image, people that you love, people that you long to shepherd with your tender, compassionate, and caring heart. We love you, O God. We thank you for your patience with us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand as we continue to worship. This song really puts into perspective our relationship with our God.
People of God, rise up.
Let us bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Lord in heaven, let us remember that in whatever context we find ourselves in, leading or following, that you oppose the proud and give grace to the humble. And so whenever we are tempted to be proud, change our hearts. Let us never be in opposition to you. Rather, let us be poor in spirit that we may be blessed by you. And so I lift up in prayer all the leaders in our church, all who give of their time, whether in church or in community, parents, people in working in teams at work, those in committees, friendships, all who lead by example, who are salt and light in this world. Help us to be shepherds as you are our shepherd. Help us be eager, willing, ready to serve. And when we are tempted to be like the nations, to be like those who have not been called, to lord it over those that are under us, change our hearts, rebuke us, because even you did not come to be served, but to serve. And we pray that we may be transformed each day, little by little, until we can have the same heart as you. We look forward to the day that you return, and on that day that you would give us a crown that is eternal and everlasting. Help us to keep that in our sight rather than those things of this world. Let us end with the words from Hebrews 13. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let us continue our worship with the giving of tithes and offerings.
Our last song of worship today is Establish the Work of Our Hands. This has been a little bit of a new song for us, but please stand now if you're able and join us in singing this awesome song.
Stand with no strength. with the favor.
Let the
Now receive the benediction. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.